the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Brothers and sisters, as we celebrate this 15th Sunday of Ordinary Time, as always, we rejoice to gather in the house of the Lord, to hear his word proclaimed and to celebrate at the altar of sacrificial love of Jesus Christ. As always, we gather as sinners, but sinners who have been redeemed in the love of God and offered the opportunity of everlasting life. We are challenged to repent of our sins constantly as we grow toward that life everlasting that the Lord Jesus offers us to guide us to the Father in the Spirit. Let us now acknowledge our sins and prepare ourselves to celebrate the sacred mysteries. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do. Through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life.
Oh,
O God, who show the light of your truth to those who go astray, so that they may return to the right path, give all who for the faith they profess are accounted Christians the grace to reject whatever is contrary to the name of Christ, and to strive after all that it does it honor, through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
Reading from the book of the prophet Isaiah. Thus says the Lord, just as from the heavens the rain and snow come down and do not return there until they have watered the earth, making it fertile and fruitful, giving seed to the one who sows and bread to the one who eats, so shall my word be that goes forth from my mouth. My word shall not return to me void, but shall do my will, achieving the end for which I sent it. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The seed that falls. From the letter of St. Paul to the Romans. Brothers and sisters, I consider that the sufferings of this present time are as nothing compared with the glory to be revealed for us. For creation awaits with eager expectation the revelation of the children of God. For creation was made subject to futility, not on its own accord, but because of the one who subjugated it, in hope that creation itself would be set free from slavery to corruption and share in the glorious freedom of the children of God. We know that all creation is groaning in labor pains even until now. And not only that, but we ourselves, who have the first fruits of the Spirit, we also groan within ourselves as we await for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
According to Matthew.
Glory to you, O Lord.
On that day, Jesus went out of the house and sat down by the sea. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat down, and the whole crowd stood along the shore. And he spoke to them at length in parables, saying, A sower went out to sow. And as he sowed, some seed fell on the path, and birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky road, where it had little soil. It sprang up at once because the soil was not deep. And when the sun rose, it was scorched, and it withered for lack of roots. Some seed fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked it. But some seed fell on rich soil, and produced fruit, 100 or 60 or 30-fold. Whoever has ears ought to hear. The disciples approached him and said, Why do you speak to them in parables? He said to them in reply, Because knowledge of the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven has been granted to you, but to them it has not been granted. To anyone who has, more will be given, and he will grow rich. From anyone who has not, even what he has will be taken away. This is why I speak to them in parables, because they look, but they do not see, and hear, but do not listen or understand. Isaiah's prophecy is fulfilled in them, which says, You shall indeed hear, but not understand. You shall indeed look, but never see. Gross is the heart of this people. They will hardly hear with their ears. They have closed their eyes, lest they see with their eyes and hear with their ears and understand with their hearts and be converted, and I heal them. But blessed are your eyes, because they see, and your ears, because they hear. Amen, I say to you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see what you see, but did not see it, and to hear what you hear, but did not hear it. Hear then the parable of the sower. The seed sown on the path is the one who hears the word of the kingdom without understanding it. And the evil one comes and steals away what was sown in his heart. The seed sown on rocky ground is the one who hears the word and receives it at once with joy. But he has no root and lasts only for a time. When some tribulation or persecution comes because of the word, he immediately falls away. The seed sown among thorns is the one who hears the word, but then worldly anxiety and the lure of riches choke the word, and it bears no fruit. But the seed sown on rich soil is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields 100 or 60 or 30-fold. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
As we continue in these summer days, these summer Sundays, these passages from the Gospel according to Matthew, I think we can look to the second reading from Paul to the Romans for a good expression of what these past Sundays have been telling us. A couple of Sundays ago in the Gospel of Matthew, we are told if we want to follow Christ, we must take our cross and follow him. Last Sunday, we were told that his burden is easy and his yoke is light. In this gospel, or actually the reading from Paul to the Romans, I believe we find an expression of another way of saying what those gospel passages were teaching us. St. Paul says to the Romans, I consider that the sufferings of this present time are as nothing compared with the glory to be revealed for us. The sufferings of this time are as nothing compared with the glory to be revealed for us. Brothers and sisters, I believe this gets to the heart of the message of the gospel. And certainly these recent passages from the gospel according to Matthew. And I think appropriately, the message is captured in the image of the seed. We hear about the seeds in the first reading from the prophet Isaiah. The waters come down and rain and snow and water the earth, and the seeds burst forth. The waters make the earth fertile and fruitful. And then, of course, in the gospel today from Matthew, from chapter 13, we have this familiar parable of the seed. The seeds that falls on various types of soil as a description of the various ways we respond to the wondrous message that Jesus Christ brings us the living Word, the incarnate Word of God. And at the heart of that message, you could say in this context, the kernel of the seed of faith is caught up in the words of Paul to the Romans. I consider that the sufferings of this present time are as nothing compared with the glory to be revealed for us. I think we can certainly look to the cross of Jesus Christ. Tremendous sufferings. The Lord of all gives his life for us and suffered long before he actually died on the cross. He suffered really throughout his ministry, and we can imagine throughout his whole time on earth, a lack of understanding of so many and rejection ultimately by his own community of faith and by the leaders, by so many that he had known when he worked as the carpenter's son. The sufferings of Christ are very real, as our sufferings are. And these words of Paul that apply to his journey, because certainly we know in the stories of Paul that he suffered, he was imprisoned, and ultimately he died because he was a disciple of Jesus Christ. I think the first reading, the psalm, and the gospel from Matthew, using that image of the seed, really calls us to reflect on what a seed is. A kernel of new life, full of possibility. I would imagine that most of us, as children, and maybe even now, are mystified, and we rejoice in the opportunity to see a seed burst forth. As the gospel tells us in another place, the seed must be willing to die, to fall to the earth and die, in order to bear good fruit. The psalm reminds us that seed that falls on good ground will yield a fruitful harvest. I think there's a temptation in all of us as we ponder the Word of God for this Sunday to be unwilling to fall to the ground and die, to be unwilling to burst forth in new life, in that fruitful harvest. It's easy for all of us to want to cling to what we have here. Even as at times it slips through our fingers, we grasp even more tightly what we have. But I think the lesson of the Word of God for this 15th Sunday of Ordinary Time is very simply that if we want to follow Jesus of Nazareth, the one who died on a cross, we have to be willing to fall to the ground and die like a seed, to burst forth with a new harvest. The parable that we hear in Matthew's gospel illustrates that clearly. And as we continue these readings from the Gospel of Matthew, I hope we can all ponder them, not just on these Sundays, these Lord's days, but throughout the coming week, to look for the ways that we are called to be that rich soil of faith in the midst of challenging times, of real suffering in this moment, trusting that there is glory to come. Brothers and sisters, in closing, I would point to that very simple but very important idea of our faith. I'll admit, and I think most of us would admit, that it's difficult to wait. The reason we live in such an instantaneous society that certainly has been disrupted to a point in our time, we're growing more accustomed to waiting in lines, to making space for each other, adapting to all that this COVID-19 has brought to us. But there's a deep element of reality buried in this image of the seed and this idea of glory to come. We, in this world, are always awaiting something more. And that's difficult for us. We see it especially in children. But if I'm honest with myself, and I think if we're all honest with ourselves, we don't like to wait. We want it now. We want the fruit to be born now. Yet part of the mystery of the gospel is that we recognize that the seeds that we are, the Word of God that enriches us and allows us to one day bear abundant fruit, that it takes time, it takes cultivation, it takes formation and nurturing. Hopefully, wherever we find ourselves in our journey through life, these readings remind us to be patient and to trust in the Lord. Patience is one of those virtues that we all probably struggle with. And once again, the image of the seed, I think, is a fitting parable image for us. We are all like those seeds that have to wait for that moment of bursting forth with new fruit, an abundant harvest. The seed has to have faith in the future that is promised in its very existence. We have to have faith in our future as the children of God. Finally, I point to the words of St. Paul to the Romans, where he says, in hope that creation itself would be set free from slavery to corruption and share in the glorious freedom of the children of God. Brothers and sisters, let us believe that a glorious freedom is our destiny. As we struggle through injustice and all the challenges that we face, so many questions of real freedom in our world today. Let us trust and believe that we hold in us a seed of a glorious freedom, because we are the children of God from our baptism. Let us take the challenge with joy and strength to live as the children of God and to bear that abundant harvest that is our destiny. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible. I believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us men and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary and became man. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. I believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. I confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and I look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. Christ teaches us through parables. Christ is the sower of the seed of God's word. Let us respond to his work by praying to the Father.
That the church in the world today may be like the rich soil yielding a harvest of 100-fold, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That the leaders of our nation will govern in a way which is accountable to God and to us, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That people who are plagued by doubt or suffering may receive the word of God and be converted, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who are close to death, that they may know the true faith and inner peace, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
That those who have gone on before us in faith will come to Christ and live forever, we pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. Father in heaven, your graces always achieve their purposes. As we make these requests in prayer, teach us to value your blessings. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Pray, brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father.
May the Lord accept the sacrifice at your hands, for the praise and glory of his name, for our good and the good of all his holy church.
Look upon the offerings of the church, O Lord, as she makes her prayer to you, and grant that, when consumed by those who believe, they may bring ever greater holiness through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right and just.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks. Lord, Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God, for in goodness you created man, and when he was justly condemned, in mercy you redeemed him, through Christ our Lord. Through him the angels praise your majesty. Dominions adore and powers tremble before you. Heaven and the virtues of heaven and the blessed seraphim worship together with exultation. May our voices, we pray, join with theirs in humble praise as we acclaim. Holy, O Lord, and all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you. In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. Therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you will to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son and filled with his Holy Spirit may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with blessed Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles and glorious martyrs, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis, our Pope, and me, your unworthy servant, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. Listen graciously to the prayers of this family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. To our departed brothers and sisters, and to all who were pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. At the Savior's command, and formed by divine teaching, we dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy, we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, Peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed. Thank you. Let us pray. Having consumed these gifts, we pray, O Lord, that by our participation in this mystery, its saving effects upon us may grow. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Go forth. The Mass is ended.
Thanks be to God.